बिहार एंड देयर यू कैन सी प्राइम मिनिस्टर मोदी
विधिवत स्वागत जी विधिवत स्वागत बौद्ध परंपराओं के अनुरूप
Prime Minister will be offering prayers at the Mahabodhi Temple. He'll also be offering prayers at the Bodhi Tree, which is the fifth succession from the original Bodhi Tree under which Gautam Buddha had attained enlightenment. In Neelam for 20 minutes, the Prime Minister will also be addressing the Buddhist monks and delegates from over 90 countries who are present there and will, in all probability, talk about the relevance of Buddhism in today's day and age.
Vijay Kranti ji, ye jo Mahabodhi temple aur jo Mahabodhi vriksh hai, apne aap mein ek bahut adbhut drishy hai wahan par aur Pradhanmantri swayam us vriksh ke niche aaj baithenge. Ji.
ऐसी कई तरीके से काम करती है और दुनिया के जो रिश्ते हैं देशों के आर्थिक व्यवस्था
इकोनॉमिक जो उनकी पावर जो है वो अपना प्रभाव दिखाती है उसमें हम लोग कहीं पर ये जो सॉफ्ट ताकत है ना कल्चर की
बिल्कुल
उसको बहुत कम करके आंकते रहे हैं
सॉफ्ट पावर
कल्चर है सॉफ्ट पावर यहाँ हम देख रहे हैं कि ये जो बोधगया में जो इवेंट हो रहा है या उससे पहले इंटरनेशनल बुद्धिस्ट कॉन्फेडरेशन की जो कॉन्फ्रेंसिस हुई हैं उन्होंने भारत की जो विदेश नीति है उसमें एक नया आयाम जोड़ा है कि देखिए दुनिया में इतने सारे देश हैं जो बहुत प्रिडोमिनेंटली बुद्धिस्ट हैं और उनके साथ अभी तक दुर्भाग्य से हमारे रिश्ते बहुत अच्छे नहीं रहे अच्छे मतलब ख़राब तो नहीं रहे लेकिन हमने कभी उनको उन पर ध्यान नहीं दिया तो सडनली अब जो हम देख रहे हैं कि पिछले 4-5 साल से ये जो ध्यान दिया जा रहा है ये कहीं दिखाता है कि जो हमारी कल्चर की जो सॉफ्ट पावर है ये भी अपना रोल बहुत अच्छा प्ले करने वाली है और मैं एक और सवाल जो मुझे बहुत महत्वपूर्ण लगता है
जी
कि अभी हम देख रहे हैं टकराव पश्चिम में खूब ज़बरदस्त है और वो कल्चर्स का टकराव है रिलीजियस लाइंस पर टकराव हो रहा है मुझे लगता है कि बहुत जल्द वो दिन आने वाला है कि जब पश्चिम के देश जो पश्चिम एशिया के देश अचानक रियलाइज़ करेंगे कि भारत से कुछ सीखा जा सकता है भारत दुनिया में एक अकेला देश है जहाँ दुनिया का हर धर्म मौजूद है और लाखों की संख्या में है लोग हमारे यहाँ जो मुस्लिम हैं ईसाई हैं कई देशों की जो ईसाई देश हैं या मुस्लिम देश हैं उनकी टोटल जो उनकी पॉपुलेशन है उससे ज़्यादा है हमारे यहाँ और हम लोग यहाँ इकट्ठा रह रहे हैं द वर्ल्ड इज़ गोइंग वेरी सून टू रियलाइज दैट इंडिया इज़ ए सोर्स ऑफ लर्निंग हाउ सो मैनी रिलीजन सो मैनी कल्चर सो मैनी लैंग्वेजेस सो मैनी ट्रेडिशंस आर लिविंग टुगेदर सर्वाइविंग एंड थ्राइविंग तो मुझे लगता है कि ये जो आज का इवेंट है ये कहीं दरवाजे खोलता है नए दुनिया को ये दिखाने के लिए कि भारत के पास और बहुत कुछ है एक हम सिर्फ जो भी इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी के लिए भारत जाने लगा है उससे ज़्यादा जो ज्ञान है जो अनुभव है इकट्ठे रहने की जो 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 नैतिक रास्ते हैं तरीके हैं
बिल्कुल जो अध्यात्म की गंगा
वो मुझे लगता है कि इंडिया इज ऑन वे ऑफ बिकमिंग ए कल्चरल सुपर पावर ए मॉरल सुपर पावर
और एक बेहतर मानवता जिसको हम कहते
बिल्कुल,
हैं
बिल्कुल।
जो एक एक मनुष्यत्व जिसको हम कहते हैं जिसमें जिसमें चिंतन है जिसमें ज्ञान है क्योंकि जैसे कि आप कह रहे हैं कि जो उपभोक्तावाद है वो तो एक तरफ है लेकिन जिसकी सबसे ज़्यादा आज ज़रूरत महसूस की जा रही है कि हम एक बेहतर इंसान तो बने
बेहतर इंसान बने बेहतर समाज बने और हमारे पास लड़ने को इतने सारे हमने कारण ढूंढ लिए मिलने के बहुत सारे कारण हैं
Bilkul.
And there's so much to learn from the life of Gautam Buddha because he exemplified renunciation, he exemplified simplicity, he exemplified compassion.
Yeah. Exactly. The compassion is something which this word, today's word, has to learn.
Karuna or Maitri.
Yeah. We have to draw power from this powerhouse of compassion. And just imagine, if there is compassion, would you have imagined something what is happening in the Middle East today?
Bilkul.
It would not. So, I hope that by organizing and giving importance to such events, Mr. Modi is somewhere encouraging a new process, you know, which offers a platform to the entire world.
और आप देख सकते हैं प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी इस समय आगे बढ़ रहे हैं
महाबोधि मंदिर का प्रवेश है ये
जी ये मंदिर के प्रवेश द्वार के बाहर प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी बोधगया में इस समय अंतर्राष्ट्रीय हिंदू और बौद्ध सम्मेलन के समापन समारोह में शिरकत करने के लिए आज बोधगया में। वैसे तो बहुत टूरिस्ट और दुनिया भर से पहुंचते हैं।
और आप एक मैं बात बताऊं आपको, मैं जैसे जापान के लोग हैं, कंबोडिया के लोग हैं, मेरी बहुत लोगों से मुलाकात हुई, जापानी विद्वान, जापानी फिलोसफर्स, पॉलिटिशियन से मेरी मुलाकात हुई, उनसे ये सुन के बड़ा मज़ेदार लगता है। वो बोले कि बाकी सब ठीक है, हम लोग हमारे यहाँ अगर कोई भारत की यात्रा कर रहा है जापानी, तो हम उसको बहुत भाग्यशाली मानते हैं। यानी हर जापानी के मन की कहीं एक कामना होती है कि मैं मरने से पहले एक बार भारत की यात्रा कर लूं,
और शायद बोध गया की यात्रा।
बोध गया तो फिर बिल्कुल उसमें सबसे ऊंची जगह है ना।
सो वुड यू से दैट दिस महाबोधि टेंपल एंड द बोधि ट्री देयर हैज सर्वड एज अ मेजर पॉइंट ऑफ अट्रैक्शन फॉर पिलग्रिम्स एंड फॉलोअर्स ऑफ द रिलीजन ऑफ बुद्धिज्म, एनी डे ऑफ द ईयर हैज प्लेड एन इंपॉर्टेंट रोल इन कीपिंग द आइडियोलॉजी एंड द आइडियल्स ऑफ बुद्धिज्म अलाइव द वर्ल्ड ओवर।
यस यस, यू गो टू दिस प्लेस एनी time in a year and you will find people from at least 50, 60, 70, 80 countries sitting there together on every day, 365 days. So it's a melting pot, it's a meeting point and it's a kind of a cultural plaza for the whole world where everybody comes and sits.
Former leaders of various countries, for example, Chandrika Kumaratunga of Sri Lanka is also present here and was part of the conference. So you were referring to outreach and you were saying that the world can learn so much from India, and this government has kept culture and Buddhism at the very center of India's diplomacy through the Act East policy when it is engaging with the East Asian countries and the Southeast Asian countries. So how do you see this imaginative out-of-the-box thinking by this government when it comes to diplomacy and others embracing this idea?
Right. I would say, I will not discredit any previous government that they did not do it. Unfortunately, the Indian politics has been running on a very funny style where very, very petty issues used to become very national issues. As you see these days, the way you know, our media treats events, and we forget major issues. So in Indian politics, we had never stopped bothering about those strengths of India, those issues where we can dominate, where we can teach the world, where we can take it. And unnecessarily, we were somewhere living in an inferiority complex. So this government has, in a way, I would say, they have dusted the table. And just somewhere putting focus that we have so many strengths in our pocket which are non-confrontational.
बिल्कुल। और यहाँ पर पूजा अर्चना करते हुए प्रधानमंत्री और विजय जी, बुद्ध ने कहा था अप दीपो भव, अपना दीपक स्वयं
बनो, अपनी यानी रोशनी का जो स्रोत है वो तुम खुद हो।
जी,
भगवान बुद्ध की सोच की जो एक बड़ी यूनिक चीज है जो शायद दुनिया के किसी और धर्म में नहीं है, बौद्ध धर्म में भगवान के अस्तित्व को नहीं माना जाता, माना जाता जो, लेकिन उसको नकारा भी, उस जो देवी शक्ति है उसको नकारा भी नहीं जाता। इसमें जो एक बहुत अच्छी बात है कि कोई भी व्यक्ति बुद्ध बनने का अधिकारी है।
बिल्कुल,
ये दिस इज समथिंग वेरी यूनिक,
जिसको ज्ञान मिल गया।
ईच इंडिविजुअल हैज द कैपेसिटी एंड राइट एंड अपॉर्चुनिटी टू learn to reach that level of wisdom where he becomes Buddha. That is Buddhahood.
Yes.
And it is believed that Gautam was one of the Buddhas. He was not the only Buddha. Gautam. So similarly, you know, the Buddhist philosophy, the Buddhist religion gives an opportunity to each person very democratically that you individually have the opportunity and wisdom to reach Buddhahood. That's something very unique.
And beyond what Neelam said, we should also perhaps today remember the Eightfold Path.
Yes.
That Gautam Buddha had initiated of right effort, right thought, right consciousness, right concentration, right conscientiousness, right speech, right conduct. How important will this be in terms of relevance in today's age?
You know, something beautiful about this is none of these points have anything religious, anything sectarian. Each point is related to our conduct as a member of the society, as individual. And just all these eight, you apply to any good Muslim. He also believes in it. Any good Christian believes in it very much.
Jeevan ka darshan
hai. Christ has said these things in little different words. In Hindu philosophy, various sects, they are preaching same thing. So, you know, at in events like what is happening today, I see something very positive, another new thing, that here, what we call secularism, unfortunately, it has been, we have been looking at secularism from a very small tunnel hole, a telescopic hole, whereas it's much larger. You know, here you see there is no religion, nothing religious happening. The 2 days conference, not one thing was religious, but a lot of philosophy, a lot of, you know, wisdom being shared. So this is an opportunity to understand that we can rise above religions and still remain spiritual and responsible to the whole society, entire society, irrespective of who practices which religion.
जी, और हम देख रहे हैं इस बीच ये सीधे दृश्य बोध गया से महाबोधि वृक्ष के नीचे बैठकर अब यहाँ पर ध्यान होगा और प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी यहाँ पर स्वयं मौजूद हैं. विजय जी, ये जो वृक्ष है इसकी टहनियों को लेकर ही तो सम्राट अशोक ने अपनी पुत्री संघमित्र और पुत्र महेंद्र को श्रीलंका भेजा था जी, और इसी धम्म का प्रचार करने के लिए.
और आप जाइए वहाँ
जी,
आप कभी वहाँ के कहीं खड़े हो जाइए आधा घंटा में, आप देखिए कि कई देशों के लोग आकर वहाँ जो पत्ते गिरे हुए होते हैं
अच्छा
बड़ी श्रद्धा से उठा ले जाते हैं. और मैं कुछ जैसे चीन में, तिब्बत में मैंने यात्राएं की एज ए फोटोग्राफर, तो मैंने देखा कि मैं कुछ पत्ते ले गया, उससे अच्छी गिफ्ट मैंने देखा, जो रिस्पांस मुझे रेस्टोरेंट में, और छोड़िए किसी रेस्टोरेंट में मैं गया हूँ और मुझे
इवन द प्राइम मिनिस्टर हैव टू हैंड्स ऑफ स्टेट एंड गवर्नमेंट गिफ्टेड सैपलिंग्स
एग्जैक्टली
द बोधि ट्री.
सो द रिस्पेक्ट एंड एक्सेप्टेबिलिटी फॉर दिस ट्री, इट्स लीव्स, और इवन जिसको मिट्टी कहते हैं वहाँ से जो सॉइल वहाँ से लोग लाते हैं, बड़े खूबसूरत कपड़े लाते हैं, झोला लाते हैं, उसमें मुट्ठी भर मिट्टी लेके घर लेके जाते हैं. और वो कहाँ, कंबोडिया जा रही है, चाइना जा रही है, ताइवान जा रही है, हांगकांग जा रही है, यानी दुनिया भर के जापान में सब जगह जाती है.
Since we were talking, Mr. Kranti, about the Buddhist ideology and its relevance, there were issues like women's empowerment, rights of labor, class discrimination, caste discrimination, that Buddha had talked about and shown the path for 2,500 years ago. And those issues are still relevant to date.
Yes, they are relevant. In one way, it's very unfortunate that we, in spite of having such great teachers like Buddha, we did not follow those teachings, and those problems are still there.
So besides solving global conflicts, social evils can also be tackled through his thoughts and teachings.
Yes, of course. You know, provided we are ready to follow.
बिल्कुल. तो बुद्ध के दिखाए मार्ग पर चलने के लिए, और जिस प्रकार
Sangam saranam gacchami. Other Sangha community for the wonderful chanting in Tibetan language or the Bodhi language. Now I would like to request most venerable Ming Quang Su to lead us in prayer for harmony and peace in the world according to the Chinese tradition.
Thank you.
तो प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी ने अभी महाबोधि वृक्ष के नीचे बैठकर ध्यान किया और जैसे कि आप बता रहे थे कि अद्भुत अनुभव होता है उस वृक्ष के नीचे बैठकर। अभी हमारे रिपोर्टर भी बता रहे थे कि एक प्रकार की शांति का।
और आज तो जो बहुत खूबसूरत बात ये थी कि कई भाषाओं में और कई परंपराएं जो हैं, यानी जापानी परंपरा भी, कंबोडिया की परंपरा भी, श्रीलंका की परंपरा भी, भारतीय भी, तिब्बती भी, सब में अलग अलग प्रार्थनाएं पढ़ी गई हैं। तो ये बहुत कम होता है कि एक साथ एट वन प्लेस यू हैव द सेम प्रेयर इन सो मेनी लैंग्वेजेस इन सो मेनी traditions.
Absolutely. It also transports us back to PM's visits to Japan, to China, to yes. Mongolia, to South Korea. And it's interesting that leadership of those countries took enough care and were courteous enough to plan PM's itinerary in such a way that he could visit Buddhist shrines, temples, monasteries, pagodas. And he got the honor of being accompanied by, say, Japan Prime Minister Shinzo Abe
yes.
to a Toji temple in Kyoto. Then Xi Jinping, the president of China
himself, yeah,
had gone to
that.
The Wild Goose Pagoda with him. And there is this talk which is there of evolving a Buddhist circuit to promote Buddhist pilgrimage centers and to promote tourism around Buddhism.
This is one thing which the Minister of Culture and Tourism pointed out, Dr. Mahesh Sharma, that India is now, although there is already a Buddhist circuit, but now the government has decided to make to develop this entire circuit, you know, Bodh Gaya, Rajgir, Kushinagar, so many places
to Sanchi, expand it.
Yeah, to connect them with each other in a manner that tourists from any country can take that package or that route, so that they have in one go they have darshan of all important places and temples and wherever Lord Buddha was associated. There is one more point which I find, because I'm a journalist, I'm a political commentator and observer. What has been happening in last about 12 years, suddenly China started taking interest in Buddhism, you know, which was something very unexpected, because China, because of their communist leanings and the history during Mao's period in last 60 years, whatever the world has been talking about was not very positive about China's approach towards religion. You know, it was Mao who declared it as poison, as opium. And it is same China, suddenly they realized that Buddhism is something to bank upon. So, very interesting, it was China who started a chain of international conferences on Buddhism. And China had almost on the verge of taking leadership, world leadership in Buddhism. So, it was at that time, that was the period of Dr. Manmohan Singh, that government of India realized that something is being usurped from India's hands. So, one political angle to all these developments is Indian government is now taking Buddhism very seriously as its link to so many countries and so many people, so many cultures. So this organization is no way different from, is not detached from that process. It is very much an integral part of that process. I am saying it as a political commentator in my own capacity. But that's what I observe. That this conference has a huge political significance, which you will see the results you will see in coming few years. You know, the way big organizations from even countries like Mongolia, who was never on our radar, Cambodia, whom we had forgotten, Thailand, whom we never considered as a real brother.
Even Vietnam,
and we have, you know, top.
पूर्व की ओर देखो और पूर्व का जगत गुरु भारत रहा है।
आप देखिए ना, बेल्जियम से आ रहे हैं,
यूरोप के देशों से
बुद्धिस्ट स्कॉलर्स आए हैं, हिंदू स्कॉलर्स आए हैं जो इसमें हिस्सा ले रहे हैं। तो मुझे लगता है कि इंडियन गवर्नमेंट, जिसको हम सॉफ्ट पावर कहें, कल्चरल डिप्लोमेसी कहें, इंडियन गवर्नमेंट इज नाउ very much alive to this fine part of international diplomacy, and I hope वी आर गोइंग टू सी सम वेरी गुड रिजल्ट्स, वेरी पॉजिटिव रिजल्ट्स।
मतलब आप ये कह रहे हैं कि जो पूर्व की ओर देखो की हमारी नीति थी जो एक्ट ईस्ट में बदली है, तो आपको क्या लगता है कि ईस्टर्न ये जो देश हैं, मुल्क हैं, उसमें विकास के साथ साथ आर्थिक संबंधों के साथ साथ ये जो हमारे बीच में कह सकते हैं जो एकता का एक सूत्र है जो कि बुद्ध ने पिरोया था और जिसमें सब देश आपस में एक कह सकते हैं ना कि एक माला की तरह पिरोए हुए मोतियों की तरह हैं, आपको लगता है कि इन चीजों से एक 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 तरह का नया रिवाइवल हम देख सकते हैं आने वाले समय में?
बिल्कुल, हम मैं बहुत गंभीरता से ये मानता हूँ कि इस रिवाइवल की भारत को बहुत ज़रूरत थी। अभी हम बहुत सीधी सीधी बात है जिसे हम छिपा नहीं सकते, हम चीन की जो जिस लेवल पर उसकी मिलिट्री पावर है, इकोनॉमिक पावर है, हम आज उसका मुकाबला करने की बहुत अच्छी हालत में नहीं है, हम बहुत ख़राब हालत में भी नहीं है, लेकिन ये नहीं कह सकते कि हम उससे बेहतर हो जाएंगे बहुत जल्दी। लेकिन ये जो रूट है, कल्चरल रूट जो है, ये ऐसा है जिससे हम बहुत सारे शॉर्टकट ले सकते हैं और वेरी पॉजिटिव शॉर्टकट्स, नॉट दैट इट्स ए नेगेटिव शॉर्टकट, बट वी हैव समथिंग ए ह्यूज जिसको हम खजाना बोलते हैं हमारे घर में है कल्चर का, और उसको हम भूल बैठे थे कि ये हमारी पूंजी है।
बिल्कुल,
आज हम रियलाइज कर रहे हैं।
टेल अस मोर अबाउट दिस रिचुअल ऑफ दाना व्हिच द प्राइम मिनिस्टर हैज परफॉर्मड वेयर इन गिफ्ट बॉक्स एंड चीवर्ड हैव बीन ऑफर्ड टू द होली संघा।
Yes, yes, and because I was participating in this conference in first 2 days, so I came to know of this particular what has happened, dana. This is a gift, of course, to Sangha, to the bhikshus, but also the participants who have flown specially from Delhi to Bodh Gaya. So this box, a beautiful box, which is prepared by the organizers, has been gifted to the participants. You know, which carries you know some holy scripts also, scarf and other things. Yeah, this is what was happening right now when they announced that the Prime Minister will perform dana.
Absolutely.
जी, और आप देख सकते हैं ये सीधे दृश्य बोध गया से जहां प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी पहुंचे हैं और इस समय महाबोधि टेंपल की परिक्रमा करते हुए और कुछ ही देर में संबोधित भी करेंगे विजय जी प्रधानमंत्री। और ये जो गैदरिंग है जिसका सिग्निफिकेंस और महत्व आप बता रहे थे अभी, निश्चित रूप से हम कह सकते हैं कि 100% ज़्यादा बढ़कर दुनिया के मुल्कों तक पहुंचेगा भारत का संदेश, जिसमें करुणा, मैत्री, ये कुछ ऐसे सिद्धांत, कुछ ऐसे जीवन मूल्य, जीवन दर्शन की बातें जिन्हें अगर हर व्यक्ति अपने जीवन में उतारे तो दुनिया एक बेहतर दुनिया बन सकती है, जिसकी आज सबसे ज़्यादा ज़रूरत है। पर्यावरण को भी बचाया जा सकता है अगर मन में करुणा हो तो अपने,
यही थीम भी यही था
जी,
इस पूरी कॉन्फ्रेंस का थीम
यही था। बूटों से भी आप प्यार मोहब्बत कर सकते हैं जिसका संदेश दिया गया है, और ये उस महाबोधि वृक्ष की टहनियाँ, पवित्र टहनियाँ जिन्होंने दुनिया भर में महात्मा बुद्ध के संदेशों को पहुँचाया है, महात्मा बुद्ध के धम्म को पहुंचाया है, वो धम्म जो विश्व शांति की कामना करता है।
एंड आवर कॉरेस्पोंडेंट अजय अर्लियर वाज कोटिंग द प्राइम मिनिस्टर व्हेन ही सेड दैट विदाउट बुद्धा द एशियन द 21st सेंचुरी कैन नॉट बिकम एशियन सेंचुरी। ही सेज दैट देयर इज यूनानिमिटी द वर्ल्ड ओवर व्हेन 21st सेंचुरी विल बी एशिया सेंचुरी, बट दैट कैन नॉट हैपन विदाउट गौतम बुद्ध।
यू नो द प्रीवियस 2 centuries हैव बीन सेंचुरीज ऑफ वॉर एंड वायलेंस। You know, the world saw 2 world wars in the last century. I don't think we can afford the 3rd one. Because now, during this process, we all have grown to a level where we can destroy ourselves far more effectively. So we can't afford another war. So we need some symbol which brings compassion, which brings tells us the basic unity between different religions, between different regions, between different peoples.
बिल्कुल, और विश्व युद्ध के साथ अगर हम आतंकवाद की बात करें, जिस प्रकार से आतंक का एक चेहरा इस समय पूरी दुनिया के सामने है और कोई देश ऐसा नहीं है जो उसे अछूता रह गया हो, शायद उसका भी हम सामना कर सकते हैं अगर बुद्ध के दिखाए हुए रास्तों पर दुनिया चलने का कहीं संकल्प ले ले।
ये जो पिछले 2500 साल में जितनी भी विभूतियाँ हुई हैं, बुद्ध का नाम लीजिए और अभी बिल्कुल जो मॉडर्न काल है, महात्मा गांधी हुए, नेल्सन मंडेला हुए, इतने सारे महापुरुष जो हुए हैं जिन्होंने टकराव के दौर में कैसे बिना टकराव किए हुए, बिना हिंसा किए हुए, बिना एक दूसरे को फिजिकली नुकसान पहुंचाए हुए किस तरह से जिसको कहें जीता जाए कि जिसमें दोनों तरफ विक्ट्री है, ये जो रास्ता है ये कहीं उसी विचार से आया जो बुद्ध ने फैलाया था।
कैन वी से दैट दिस फाइट अगेंस्ट टेररिज्म विल बैंक ऑन द वेरी बेसिक प्रिमाइस ऑफ बुद्धिज्म विच इज स्प्रेडिंग कंपैशन एंड मे बी बाई चेंज ऑफ हार्ट extremists and terrorists can give up arms and can come back into the mainstream? Because I remember that at the start of the conference, the Prime Minister had taken a swipe at Pakistan without naming Pakistan and said that the constraints of conflict resolution mechanisms become all the more apparent when non-state actors control huge territories.
Exactly.
And they resort to bloodshed.
Yes.
So by saying that issues like terrorism can be tackled, are we banking on change of heart by such terrorist and extremist organizations?
As we know, there is no other choice. Today, you know, there are two choices. One is that you settle the scores with power, with force. And unfortunately, the availability of power and force or means of hurting others, violence which we say, are tremendous. And you know, once you start, it is very easy to start a war, but you can't stop it, because then everybody has a license to hit back. So ultimately, the final solution, if we want to survive in this given situation and find a better solution, is dialogue, talking to each other, understanding others' point.
Hmm. Which is what Hinduism and Buddhism promote.
This is something very unique about both Hinduism and Buddhism. And luckily, if you look at it, Buddhism is the basic thought material Buddha received was from his history, and that is the the society where he lived. It's the Hindu Vedic society,
aur is samay
so all the thought came from there.
Ji, Pradhanmantri अवलोकन कर रहे हैं एक
एग्जीबिशन
प्रदर्शनी का जी, और ये पूरा मार्ग दर्शाया गया है और किस प्रकार से बौद्ध धर्म दुनिया भर में फैला और उसके विभिन्न नक्शे हम यहाँ पर देख रहे हैं और प्रधानमंत्री को बताया जा रहा है शायद ऐतिहासिक नज़रिए से किस प्रकार से बौद्ध धर्म फला फूला हिंदुस्तान से चलता हुआ विभिन्न मुल्कों की ओर। एक बात और जो कि महात्मा बुद्ध के बारे में कही जाती है वो ये कि वो कर्म योगी थे, जन्म से नहीं व्यक्ति कर्म से महान बनता है।
ये जो थ्योरी है
ये खासतौर से जो हमारा बटा हुआ समाज है, जब ये जो एक सूत्र वाक्य,
ये जो विचार है ना,
है ना,
ये बहुत शक्ति देता है। हाँ। सबसे कमजोर आदमी को,
बिल्कुल,
जब सबसे कमजोर आदमी को ये आश्वासन मिलता है कि तुम भी बुद्ध बन सकते हो, तुम बोधिसत्व तक पहुंच सकते हो, और उसके लिए तुम्हें बहुत पैसे की जरूरत नहीं है, बहुत सारे दूसरे औजार की जरूरत नहीं है, तुम्हारा अपना जो मन है, जो मस्तिष्क है, जो तुम्हारे पास विचार है, उसको कंट्रोल करके उसके ऊपर बिल्ड अपॉन इट एंड यू कैन रीच बुद्धाहुड, जिसको बोधिसत्व कहते हैं। तो ये जो विचार सबसे कमज़ोर आदमी को मिलता है कि वो भी सबसे ऊँचे ऊपर पहुँच सकता है, आई थिंक दैट इज़ द बेसिक ए ग्रेट कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन टू द होल सोसाइटी, दैट यू आर एम्पावरिंग द लीस्ट एम्पावर्ड पर्सन।
And he also believed in the power of organization. He thought that ekla chalo re or walking alone or treading alone,
you know,
is
sangha idea,
the
bhikshus, you know, the monks, he never allowed the monks in the Vinaya, the rules of monkhood which he gave, never allowed them to cook at home. He demanded them, he expected them, for each every time's food, you go to people, go to society, beg for your next food, and take only that much which is enough for the next food. And when you take food, talk to people, give them some wisdom. So this is how Buddhism spread to ordinary people, the household. He reached the household. This is something big, very very successful. You just now said organizer. He was a fantastic organizer. So this is how he used each member of the Sangha to reach out to 100 of people.
Absolutely, because if one has to service humankind, one can't do it in a silo.
Yes.
So you have to connect with people at large, which is why the power of organization or the power of society becomes
reaching
important.
Out, yes, reaching out, organizing them. And that's why he was able to enroll not only the poorest man in the street, the kings.
और सबसे बड़ी बात शायद ये थी कि एक निर्भीकता के साथ तर्कपूर्ण बात के जरिए लोगों तक अपनी बात को पहुंचाना, ये भी तो एक बहुत बड़ी शक्ति होती है जो मन की और भीतर की शक्ति से आती है।
निर्भीकता जो है फिर वहीं से आती है कि अगर आपको अपने ऊपर विश्वास है, आप पक्का जानते हैं, आप सच के साथ हैं, सही रास्ते पर हैं, तो निर्भीकता आ जाती है। आप देखिए जितने सोशल रिफॉर्मर्स हुए हैं, इवन जो पॉलिटिकल रिफॉर्मर्स हुए हैं, जो पॉलिटिकल जिन्होंने स्ट्रगल्स बहुत बड़ी बड़ी की हैं, गांधी हैं, नेल्सन मंडेला हैं, डेसमंड टूटू हैं, ये सब इनकी ताकत का सोर्स क्या था? देवर कन्विंस्ड कि मैं सही रास्ते पर हूँ, मैं सत्य के साथ हूँ और स्वार्थ नहीं है, सेल्फिशनेस नहीं है वहाँ पर।
How significant is a statement
from our honorable prime minister when he was chief minister over there to make this Devni Mori a place of global spiritual Buddhism destination, and that's the reason we have started flow of activities after that. Devni Mori is the place in North Gujarat. It is a place called Shamlaji. Devni Mori is a village nearby, and it is in the basin of Aravalli Ranges, amidst forests, and the Meswa Reservoir is also there. From there, in 1959, the renowned archaeologist Mr. S. N. Chaudhary has found the relics of Lord Buddha, which is preserved at the moment at MS University Vadodara. And along with that, we have found several other objects also, which we'll be portraying or displaying or showcasing them in our project. Next. This is the site, and the government has taken the initiative. They have allocated 100 acres of land to begin with, and we have already identified some 200, 300 acres land around it to make it a real global kind of a significant Buddhist destination. Just to get the idea of space planning and all,
we have started making proposals, though it is not final, and we are shortly calling the architects and conservationists and restorers from all around the world to Gujarat for an international workshop to get the collaborative vision for the architecture of the project. But we have started in thinking in some direction because there is a lake over there. So actually it's not a design presentation, so I won't thrash upon design. But we have started taking care that the environment should be well protected by our design. So all the depressions, they have been converted to lakes and like that. Next. So this stupa, we have thought of, we'll keep the relics, we'll showcase the relics of Lord Buddha. It's 108 meters structure, 76 meters up the ground and beneath the ground under the lake. So there are some images, and they are all conceptual images, it can be changed. Next. Viharas, stupas, scriptures, libraries, knowledge center, kind of Buddhist university, everything will be included. State of the art museum also will be part of the project. And there is another conceptual plan which we have made. It's the statue of Lord Buddha, which will showcase the museum in itself, and the relics will be displayed at the top of the statue. Next. So this could be the kind of section of that statue. Again, the statue is also 108 meters, and it will be showcasing the all the stages of the life of Buddha at every floor. And as the Buddha's life was progressive, we have made a ramp throughout the central core, and on top the relics will be displayed. Next, some more images of the same concept. Next, some of the plans. And not only that, we are going to develop only Devani Mori. There are several other places of Buddhist archaeological sites over there in Gujarat. And we'll be making the entire circuit for Buddhist destination throughout the Gujarat. As you can see, it is covering the entire Gujarat almost. Next. We have done quite a lot of journey. We have started unfolding the vision which was given to us, and the government is very actively involved in this process. We have associated International Buddhist Confederation also with us for this particular project, and we have done an MOU during this vibrant summit with them. The initial fund is also allocated by the government of Gujarat. And we have already presented these concepts to His Holiness Sri Dalai Lamaji and the Mahanayakas of Sri Lanka. And we have formed a committee of some members from Government of Gujarat, some members from International Buddhist Federation, Confederation, and the architect. Next. And within this year, we want to do some more things. We are inviting architects, planners, and restorers from all around the world for an international workshop to develop the collaborative vision for the project in Gujarat. And we also want to invite Buddhist scholars and opinion makers to Gujarat to have detailed objectives for this particular project. We are forming several subcommittees for to take care of different aspects of the projects. And we are making some documentaries and movies. And we are completing all types of surveys which are required to do before the design and the execution starts within this year. Next. And for several years to come, by 2020 to 2021, we like to complete the entire Buddhist circuit project, including the project of Devani Mori. We have a small movie with us. Which I think you can see, it will give the idea of the other destination which we are having at Gujarat. Thank you.
Western part of India lures travelers with its rich treasure of cultural attributes, remnants of the past, diverse languages, and colorful ambience. This western state of India also maintains footprints of Buddhism. Junagadh district has been a prominent Buddhist center right from the times of Ashoka's reign. Most of these caves are carved from monolithic rocks and are famous for their exotic art forms and symbolic inscriptions. Kambhalida caves are situated in Gondal near Rajkot. The site boasts of identifiable carvings of Bodhisattva and is one of the most important centers of worship for followers of Buddhism. Remains of a Buddhist monastery were discovered at Varnagar. It is said that Huan Sang, a Chinese Buddhist scholar and pilgrim, had visited the site in 640 AD. He had chronicled that over 1,000 monks and 10 monasteries were flourishing in the region. Talaja caves are visited by domestic and international travelers alike. Ebhala Mandapa is the most impressive structure at this site, and it's a big hall dominated by four octagonal pillars. The Sana caves offer remnants of a Buddhist establishment and are located near Rajula in the Amreli district. A monolithic stone pillar and seven caves dot the Buddhist presence in Kadiya Dungar, which is located in the Bharuch district. Amongst all the Buddhist caves located at Upparkot, the most popular is the one known as Bodha Gufa. This group of caves is constructed in three tiers. Two stories have regular floors, while the lower tier is marked by the presence of an open court. Dating over 1600 years back, Devni Mori is known to be an important monastic center for followers of Buddhism. Located in the frills of River Meshwo near Shamuaji, Devni Mori is one of the five places in the world where body relics of Lord Buddha have been found. It has been the vision of Honorable Prime Minister of India, Sri Narendra Modi, to recreate the divine abode of Lord Buddha in Devni Mori as one of the most important global Buddhist spiritual destinations. A memorandum of understanding with the International Buddhist Confederation, allotment of land and initial fund is being facilitated by the government of Gujarat under the leadership of Chief Minister Srimati Anandiben Patel. Gujarat has been mentioned in several Buddhist books and literature. During his visit to India in 640 AD, the renowned Chinese traveler Huan Zhang had noticed the presence of over 200 monasteries which provided shelter to more than 13,000 monks. As the state actively pursues the development of a tourist circuit of historical Buddhist heritage, come to Gujarat and walk the path of Buddha, unveil ancient wisdom, and step back in time to enlighten yourself.
Thank you, Mr. Anil Patel and Mr. Ojas Hirani, for your wonderful presentation.
That was a presentation on the Buddhist spiritual circuit, which was being seen by the Prime Minister. We were talking about it earlier. The plan, now we know, is to conclude it by 2020-2021.
Yes.
And various places in Gujarat were shown, and they will all be connected to various places which are of significance as far as the Buddhism religion is concerned. So a major move to promote cultural tourism as well as spiritual tourism through various places of significance for this religion.
You know, I look at it a little more than tourism and cultural development. Actually, when these, you have seen in Europe especially, you know, they developed certain areas which originally had no history, but they just created, developed those areas, and they developed in such a manner that each region had a few. So you could attract tourists from across the world who come, and in one visit they can go to so many places, and that saw a lot of economic development in those areas. And once you are on the mindscape of people across the world, then they will start thinking in other terms. For example, if I'm only giving you example, a Japanese tourist comes for on a spiritual visit to India, goes to a few places, and when he goes back, when he is deciding to expand his business, don't you think India will be somewhere in his on the mindscape? When he is thinking of so many choices of places, India will be surely there. Otherwise, had this person not come here, India may not have been there at all. So you know, you see that the impact is multilateral.
जी, तो मतलब आपको लगता है कि खासतौर से जो ऐतिहासिक धरोहरों को संभालने की, सहेजने की और उनको कहीं ना कहीं विचार और ज्ञान से जोड़कर अगर आप चलते हैं तो वाकई दुनिया में असर
उसका असर बहुत लेवल्स पर होता है। वो सिर्फ कल्चरल लेवल नहीं होता, सिर्फ स्पिरिचुअल नहीं होता है, सोशल सिर्फ नहीं होता है, उसकी इकोनॉमिक डायमेंशंस होती हैं और फिर वो बढ़ के पॉलिटिकल डायमेंशंस आती हैं उसकी। कि जब आप अपने आप सोचिए कि जब भारत के बारे में कोई भी इनमें से सरकार फैसला करेगी या विचार करेगी, और कंबोडिया की सरकार है, जापान की सरकार है, कोरिया की है, ताइवान की है, जब वो भारत के बारे में सोचेंगे और कहीं कल्चरल लिंक भी है तो पूरी संभावना है कुछ पॉजिटिव सोचेंगे। न्यूट्रल नहीं होगा, नेगेटिव भी नहीं होगा, पॉजिटिव की संभावना बढ़ जाती है। तो ये मैं इसको मानता हूँ, ये इन्वेस्टमेंट है और ये कोई सिर्फ एक रिलीजियस या कल्चरल एक्टिविटी नहीं है। इट्स ए लॉन्ग टर्म इन्वेस्टमेंट इनटू योर फ्यूचर।
पर जिस तरह से हमने देखा है कि खास तौर पर जी कुछ
As in Sanskrit, there is no place more appropriate and elevating than Bodh Gaya for inspiring and institutionalizing such noble work. Bodh Gaya has the credentials to emerge and must emerge as the global symbol and vehicle for enlightenment, peace, and hope for civilizational, spiritual, and cultural harmony. A Buddhist spiritual and civilizational institution that will bring together and make the entire Buddhist world participate in this momentous task will be built in Bodh Gaya in the coming 3 years. Hindu civilizational and spiritual institutions will be invited to work with this new Buddhist institution to share the responsibility for global peace and harmony. Buddhist spiritual leaders will approach governments of all Buddhist nations to support this monumental and noble task of developing Buddha Gaya as an international center for Buddhism for the enlightenment of all humankind. We call for support from the government of India for the development of infrastructure and other public utilities in the area. A team of experts will be constituted to begin the noble work, and the responsibility for this purpose shall be given to a committee. Thank you very much for your kind of support. And now I would like to express a little feeling of myself on this occasion. Of course, I don't keep the statistics and data, but during my life, I'm not aware about any other prime minister's visit to this holy land of Buddha. So in this case, today, our prime minister, Honorable Shri Narendra Modi ji, has shown what level of importance he has been putting in dealing with the Buddhist nations across the Asia, and what level of respect and devotion he expresses towards the Buddha's great teachings. So I would like to request all my brothers and sisters to understand that and take this message to all your nations and all your countries, and make sure that this message is heard loud and clear by your leaders and public. And here, as yesterday I heard from some of our participants, that the present Prime Minister of this country is the second Ashoka that appeared into the 21st century. Ashoka has great role played in diffusing Buddha's teachings in many nations. Now, Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi ji is kind of re-vibrating that kind of action that the great Ashoka has started. So we need to understand that, and with our understanding, we need to support it and do whatever is possible in our own capacity. So with these feelings, I would like to stop here. And at the same time, now I would like to request the Most Honorable Prime Minister of Republic of India, Shri Narendra Modi ji, to bless us with your wise advice and guidance, what we can do to serve the humanity in to protect this world. Please give us enlightened kind of guidance. Thank you very much.
श्री रामनाथ कोविंद, गवर्नर ऑफ बिहार, वेनरेबल खंबा लांबा डेमरेल फ्रॉम मंगोलिया, वेनरेबल मिंग कुआंगशी फ्रॉम ताइवान, वेनरेबल थी थियन ताम फ्रॉम वियतनाम, वेनरेबल तेलो टुक्कु रिम्पोंच from Russia, Venerable Banagala Upatissa from Sri Lanka, Venerable Lama Lobjang, my minister colleague, Shri Kiran Riju, Minister Liangpo Nangbe Dorji of Bhutan, Minister Bayor Satak of Mongolia, Venerable members of the Mahasangha, visiting ministers and diplomats from foreign countries. I'm very happy to be in the midst of all of you. I feel very blessed to be here at Bodh Gaya. After Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru and Atal Bihari Vajpayee, I have the opportunity to visit this sacred place. I'm meeting you all on a very special day. Today, we in India are observing Teachers' Day to commemorate the birth anniversary of our second president, a great scholar and a teacher, Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan. In this symposium, we have been talking about one of the most impactful teachers in world history, Gautam Buddha. His teaching have inspired millions of people over centuries. Today, we are also celebrating Janmashtami, the day Lord Krishna was born. The world has so much to learn from Lord Krishna. When we talk about Lord Krishna, we say, Sri Krishnam Vande Jagat Gurum. Sri Krishna, the teacher of all teachers and the guru of all gurus. Both Gautam Buddha and Lord Krishna have taught the world so much. The themes of this conference, in a way, are inspired by the values and ideals given by these two greats. Sri Krishna gave his message before the start of the Great War in the Mahabharata. And Lord Buddha repeatedly emphasized on rising above warfare. The message by both of them was about establishing dharma. Both of them gave great prominence to principles and processes. Gautam Buddha gave the eightfold path and the Panchashil, while Sri Krishna gave valuable lessons of life in the form of Karma Yoga. These two divine souls had the strength to bring people together, rising above differences. Their teachings are most practical, eternal, and are more relevant in this day and age than ever before. The place where we are meeting makes it even more special. We are meeting in Bodh Gaya, a land that has distinctive place in the history of humankind. This is the land of enlightenment. Years ago, what Bodh Gaya got was Siddhartha. But what my great privilege to have participated in the inaugural function of the first International Hindu Buddhist Initiative on Conflict Avoidance and Environmental Consciousness, hosted by the Vivekananda International Foundation and Tokyo Foundation, with the support of the International Buddhist Confederation at Delhi day before yesterday. The conference was conceptualized on shifting the paradigm from conflict resolution to conflict avoidance, and from environmental regulation to environmental consciousness. I had shared my sum of thoughts on the two critical themes which are threatening humanity as no other challenge before. I recall how, in the context of both issues and for changing the global paradigm of thinking, the world is looking to the Buddha today as conflict resolution mechanism and environmental regulations, both of them dependent on the instrumentality of nation states, are increasingly failing to measure up to challenges. Spiritual and religious leaders, and also intellectuals, largely from Buddhist societies, participated in the two-day conference and deliberated on the two issues. At the end of the two-day conference, and after a churning in which spiritual, religious, and intellectual leaders participated, the Tokyo Foundation has announced that they have decided to hold a similar conference in January 2016. And other Buddhist nations have also offered to hold similar conferences in their countries. This is an extraordinary development which coincides with the rise of Asian as an economic and civilizational phenomena. The themes of the conference, informed and shaped by the Hindu, Buddhist, civilizational and cultural perspective, promise to deepen the notion of conflict avoidance philosophy and environmental consciousness in Asia and beyond. The two-day conference seems to have arrived at a broad consensus on both issues. On the issue of conflict, most of which are being driven by religious intolerance, the participants in the conference seem to have agreed that while there is no problem about the freedom to practice one's religion, it is when the radical elements try to force their own ideologies that the potential for conflict arises. On these issues of environment, the conference seems to have agreed that the philosophic understanding underpinning of the dharma which places the protection of natural heritage is critical for sustainable development. I may add that the United Nations too has arrived at the view that sustainable development is achievable only through aligning development to the local culture of the people. This, in my view, is a positive turn in the development modeling of the world of diversity. I may add that the turn in thinking at the global level has created the ecosystem for the Hindu Buddhist societies to carry forward their consensual ideas to the global flora. I personally consider the Hindu Buddhist Conference on Conflict Avoidance and Environmental Consciousness as an important development in a world that seems to be short of durable ideas on both issues. Hindu philosophy was one of the greatest beneficiaries of the advent and the teaching of the Lord Buddha. Many scholars have analyzed the impact of Buddha on Hinduism. In fact, Adi Shankar was even a critic for the way he was influenced by the Buddha, and Shankara was called as a Prachanna Buddha, meaning Shankar was Buddha in disguised form. That was the extent of influence of the Buddha on Adi Shankara, regarded by many as the tallest Hindu philosopher. At the mass level, Buddha was so venerated that Jayadeva, in his Git Govinda, even praised him as Mahavishnu or God himself who descended to preach Ahimsa. So Hinduism, after the Buddha's advent, became Buddhist Hinduism or Hindu Buddhism. They are today an inseparable amalgam. This is how Swami Vivekananda raised Buddha. I quote, "At the time Buddha was born, India was in need of a great spiritual leader, a prophet. Buddha never bowed down to anything, neither Veda, nor caste, nor priest, nor customs. He fearlessly reasoned so far as reason could take him. Such a fearless search for truth and such love for every living thing the world has never seen. Buddha was more brave and sincere than any teacher. Buddha was the first human being to give to this world a complete system of morality. He was good for good's sake. He loved for love's sake. Buddha was the great preacher of equality. Every man and woman had the same right to attain spirituality. That was his teaching. I would personally call India Buddhist India, as it has imbibed all the values and virtues of the teachings of Buddha by the religious scholars incorporating them in their literature. When this highest tribute is paid by one of the great Hindu philosophers, would it be wrong to call today's Hinduism in quality and substance as a Buddhist Hinduism? Buddha is the crown jewel of the Indian nation, which accepts all ways of worship of all religions. This quality This quality of Hinduism in India was a product of many great spiritual masters. Chief amongst them was Buddha. And this is what sustains the secular character of India. The enlightenment which Buddha attained in Bodh Gaya also led the light of enlightenment in Hinduism. At the first servant of this ancient nation, I revere Buddha as a reformer of not only Hinduism, but also the world, who has given all of us a new worldview and vision, which is critical for the survival of all of us and the entire world. I recognize how Buddhists all over the world revere Bodh Gaya as a place of pilgrimage. We in India would like to develop Bodh Gaya so that it can become the spiritual capital and civilizational bond between India and the Buddhist world. The government of India would like to provide all possible support that its Buddhist cousin nations need for the satisfaction of their spiritual needs from this holiest of holy places for them. I'm happy to read the declaration of Buddhist religions and spiritual leaders. This declaration is the result of hard work and extensive dialogue, which is why it is a pioneering document that will show us the way ahead. I also echo Prime Minister Shinzo Abe of Japan, who the other day highlighted the importance of tolerance, appreciation of diversity, and spirit of compassion and fraternity. His message to this August gathering and his continuous support for this furthering this initiative is a matter of great strength for us. Once again, my congratulations and best wishes to you all. This conference has raised a hope and urge to go beyond clash and create a dialogue framework for civilizational harmony and world peace. I wish you well in your constant and determined efforts to ensure that our wisdom reaches the future generations, and that too in a manner in which they can practically relate to. This is essential not for us, for them or them, but for the progress of the entire human race and the beautiful surroundings which we have got from Mother Nature. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, Most Honorable His Excellency Shri Narendra Modi ji, the Prime Minister of the Republic of India, for this wonderful and wise address to this great gathering of leaders, philosophers, thinkers, and spiritual masters. Now I would like to request Most Venerable Lama Lobsang Ji, the General Secretary of International Buddhist Confederation, to offer word of thanks for His Excellency's wonderful and invigorating speech on this occasion. Thank you.